As we've journeyed together through this series to better understand wolves, we've learned about their biology and the process of reintroduction here in Colorado, including the important role of our stakeholders. But what happens when wolves truly become a part of the landscape? How can we successfully coexist? Wolves are mighty predators, able to take down large prey, including elk and moose. This is not only a thing of wonder for many, but also a cause of worry for some. Are they interested in more than just their prey? Are they interested in us, our livestock, or even our pets? Although prey like elk instinctively know to stay away from wolves, some people may be excited to see these wolves back on Colorado's landscape. While wolves may become more and more a part of the environment, the chances of seeing one in the wild is still pretty rare. Because of their low numbers and shy nature, hikers and backpackers probably won't have too many glimpses of these elusive creatures. Wolves, like most wild animals, also try to avoid humans. More often than not, you could see or hear signs that they are in the area, rather than get an actual view of one. When out on the trail, dogs can be one of our best hiking buddies. Wildlife usually sees dogs as a threat, but in some instances, predators like wolves may be a threat to our furry friends. One of the best ways we can help protect our pets, as well as our wildlife, is to keep dogs on a 6-foot leash when hiking or inside the tent when camping. By keeping dogs on leash and secured, we can keep them and wildlife safe and unharmed. Wolves are known to kill livestock since they look similar to their typical prey. Research, as well as our past experiences with wolves, has given us several solutions to help prevent wolf predation on livestock. This includes techniques like removing food sources that can attract wolves and scaring wolves off with guard dogs or bright lights and loud sounds. Funny enough, tying red flags on a string has also helped to serve as a deterrent for a period of time. How, you might ask? Flattery lines, as they're known, have been used for several centuries to spook wolves, again, keeping them away from a herd of livestock. Working with stakeholders is a key to finding solutions for both people and wolves. Colorado Parks and Wildlife works with all who are interested in and impacted by wolf reintroduction here in Colorado. This includes hunters, hikers, ranchers, and more. Local district wildlife management officers are available to help problem solve and find solutions when it comes to living with wildlife. For example, Colorado Parks and Wildlife already works closely with ranchers and farmers whose livestock have been killed by large predators like bears and mountain lions. This relationship will continue as wolves return to Colorado's outdoors. Landowners are provided recommendations and tools to deter wildlife, as well as compensation to help financially reimburse livestock loss. As wolves become a part of the landscape, our job is to not only manage potential human and wildlife conflicts, but we also need to support wolves and other species to ensure healthy and sustainable wildlife populations across the state. Research is key to the success of coexisting with wolves in Colorado. This can be handled in many different ways, depending on the goals and what population numbers look like. One research technique we will use includes tracking wolves using collars to determine where they are traveling throughout the state, including if they move into other states. Wolves can be collared, particularly those that are reintroduced, but it would be difficult and expensive to collar every wolf that is out there. This smart predator is hard to capture since they tend to avoid people. Because of these challenges, other methods are needed to determine their health and movement. It may even take getting a little dirty. Other visual signs like tracks and dens can help us determine where packs may be located and if they're breeding. Scat, or poop as many of us know it, can also give insight into where wolves are, what they are eating, and even genetics. You can learn about the pack and who is related to whom. Did you ever think poop could be so helpful? Researching wolves sometimes starts not just with the wolves themselves, but the wildlife they depend on. Elk can be monitored to see how predators and other factors are affecting them. Since wolves tend to hunt more vulnerable or smaller animals in a herd, researchers can compare elk calf survival rates to population sizes for wolves. Survival of calves depends a lot on their size and the overall health of the cow elk raising them. While wolves can still kill larger elk, the overall population of the herd is typically less affected by removing a larger animal, which is why monitoring elk calf survival rates can be a useful tool. Regardless if you're eager or concerned to see wolves out on our public lands, we all can make sure the outdoors are safe for people, wolves, and other wildlife by working together and keeping our distance. Thank you for joining me during this video series to learn about gray wolf reintroduction and what it means for Coloradans. Together, we have explored why it is important to understand the science, history, and the role of stakeholders in order to have a successful reintroduction. As you continue to learn about gray wolves on your own, consider the various viewpoints of different stakeholders and the needs of both people and wolves to help make wolf reintroduction successful in Colorado.